Greetings for the day. Welcome to another session of Computer Networks. My name is Muhammad Rahmat Ali. In today's session, we are going to study and have a look on the topic World Wide Web. Before going into the topic, let me revise what we have studied in the previous session. We studied about the email or electronic mail, the architecture of email, the technical things related to the email, advantages of the email. Now, in today's session, we're going to learn about the World Wide Web. What actually is World Wide Web and what is the advantage of World Wide Web and how World Wide Web is being introduced and what is the evolution with reference to World Wide Web. Now, what actually is World Wide Web? Before starting this, let me clear the difference between World Wide Web and Internet. Most of the people have a doubt that World Wide Web and Internet are the same thing, but the fact is these two are two different things. World Wide Web is very much different from Internet. Now, what is Internet? Internet is a connection of interrelated networks, or Internet are the connection of different devices which communicate with one another, whereas WWW or World Wide Web is a web of networks which is been used by some protocols to communicate with one another. Now, to explain you this thing in a very detailed manner, let me consider the application that we are using. For instance, WhatsApp, for an instance, IMO, for an instance, your Snapchat, your Instagram. We will not be using World Wide Web, but we are been using the Internet. But not the World Wide Web. It means Internet is very much important, whereas World Wide Web is a combination or a group of networks which are being interconnected with one another. Okay, now, for instance, I'll tell you an example. Let me consider ISL is a college and your destination or your home is a place. Now, the road which is connecting the college to your home is World Wide Web. So it is a web of networks. It is a web of network which is being used to communicate with one another in a similar way or in a similar platform or in a similar place. We will be communicating with one user to the another. Now, moving forward, what it says. A technical definition of World Wide Web is all the resources and users on the internet that are using hypertext transfer protocol. Any of the person who is using hypertext transfer protocol or HTTP or HTTPS, then that particular person is using World Wide Web. It is meaning using World Wide Web, and the best way of using this World Wide Web are the web browsers that we will be using. Or you can say the web browser that you are using, by that we can implement World Wide Web. Now, a broader definition comes from the organization that web inventors, his name is Tim Berners-Lee, helped found the World Wide Web. Okay, and World Wide Web is been monitored by W3 Consortium. What is this W3 Consortium? World Wide Web Consortium. So W3 Web monitors the internet, and there is no one who is owning this World Wide Web. For instance, if I tell you who owns this country, no one owns this. It is of everyone. Nobody can single-handedly say that I own this particular thing. If you have a phone, you can say I own that phone. Why? Because you own the authority of owning this. But when it comes to owning a land of a country or owing a particular things with reference to the country place or a road, you cannot say nobody owns that road. That government who is there, they are partially giving their resources, giving their services for that particular country, but they doesn't owe that country. In the same way, World Wide Web is not been owned by everyone, but everyone uses this particular World Wide Web. Now, the World Wide Web is a universe of network accessible information on ambient of human knowledge. Now, why actually this World Wide Web is being used? The main reason why World Wide Web is used is to get information with reference to different domains and different knowledges. Now, for an instance, if I give you 10 pages of notes and I'll tell you to tell what is been written in that particular pages, then it is very difficult for you to read all of those things. And also, if I give you only one paper stating, if you want the topic of first unit, you need to scroll back to page number 3. If you want to get the notes of chapter number 5, you need to go to page number 8. Or if you want to access the notes of 10th unit, you can go to page number 7. In this way, if I tell you, then this will be very much helpful for you to understand and to grab things in a better way. The same thing was been applied by World Wide Web. Whenever you type www.google.com, it displays a page in which you type a thing stating that I want this particular thing. Or else, if you say www.yahoo.com, so it will specifically make you to go to that particular place. In a sense, this will help you to understand that particular or to relate to that particular information of things. Now, the next term or the next value, what it says, in simple terms, the World Wide Web is a way of exchanging information between computers on the internet, tying them together into a vast collection of interactive multimedia resources. This is about World Wide Web. Now, what is the evolution of this World Wide Web? Now, World Wide Web was created by Timothy Brenzley in 1989 at CERN in Geneva. World Wide Web came into existence as a proposal by him to allow researchers to work together effectively and efficiently at CERN. Eventually, it became World Wide Web. Now, moving towards the evolution of the diagrammatical representation of World Wide Web, in Web 1.0, what was the thing? It had all of the static web pages. It had all the static pages in which you will be scrolling from one system to another system, from one page to another page, from another page to third page. In this way, you used to scroll down between the pages, and these pages were static pages. Static page in the sense that can be, which it does not change, which is not interactive. That type of pages was there in Web 1.0, and also it was browser where most publishing and no communities, and there were no communities of interaction. Why? Because as the page is very much static, you can just get the information, you cannot write the information over there. It means if at all there is something which has been written on the notice board, it cannot be changed, but you can read what it has been there. For an example, if you see a calendar, you can see what is been written on the calendar, but you cannot write anything on the calendar stating that if you write that particular thing, that thing will change on every of the place. But that thing can be changed only to your particular things. So these type of things are called as static web pages. Now, with reference to the Web 2.0, as the time went, it has enhanced itself to Web 2.0, in which the introduction of social media was there, the keyword search was introduced, and rich user experiences along with tagging was there. Now, the disadvantages which was there in Web 1.0 is the advantage in Web 2.0. What is the advantage? In this, the pages are dynamic. How you can say the pages are dynamic? With reference to social media, if you want to comment on any of the posts, you can comment it. But whereas in Web 1.0, you cannot comment anything. Why? Because it is static. And also, your point to be remembered, if at all if you are commenting also, it will not reflect to other people. But whereas in Web 2.0, if at all if you are committing or if at all you are commenting on any of the posts, that will be reflected to whole of the internet. And also with reference to the keyword search was been introduced with reference to Web 2.0, in which I personally can search my own information. For instance, you want to search particularly about World Wide Web on internet. So you will be enlisted with different pages which says about this World Wide Web. You will be given videos, you will be given articles, you will be given papers. Also, you will be given some of the website addresses where you can go and learn with reference to this World Wide Web. And also, it has got rich user experiences. In the sense, you can feel that thing that this website is answering my particular question. And the last one is with reference to the tagging. Now, with reference to the Web 3.0, as the time passed, now the things are been shifted from laptop computers to mobile phones. Everything and everyone wants everything on the tip of their finger, not on the keyboard. Everyone wants everything on the tip of the finger, not on the keyboard. So what was introduced? Web 3.0 was introduced, in which highly mobile configuring websites were developed, mobile centric websites were developed. It has OpenID, it has semantic search, also it has got microblogging. So this is the evolution with reference to World Wide Web. I hope you understood something with reference to this World Wide Web. In Web 1.0, static web pages were there, browser ways were there, and also mostly it had only got publishing, no interaction. And the last one is like there were no communities wherein you can have an interaction. Whereas the disadvantages of these things were been taken into advantage in Web 2.0, and in this social media was been introduced with reference to interacting with the things, and dynamic pages were introduced, and also it has got keyword searches so that we can search a particular keyword and can have the results oriented with reference to how the result is coming, by which means the result is coming is a different thing, but it has given an option of searching a particular option with reference to that particular website or with reference to that particular thing. The next one is with reference to the rich user experiences, tagging, and also with reference to the Web 3.0, it has got high mobile, mobile oriented websites and all these things. Now moving forward, the architecture of World Wide Web. Now the architecture is divided into several layers as shown in the following. This is the pictorial representation with reference to the architecture of World Wide Web, in which you have different things with reference to cryptography, with reference to ontologies, with reference to RDFS, with reference to RDF, with reference to XML, with reference to Unicodes, and also with reference to the cryptographic and trust and proofs of the things. So we'll study about these things in the coming sessions and in the coming things. As of now, this is the architecture of World Wide Web. Now, the first one is the identifiers and the character set that is being used by World Wide Web. The first one is the URI, which means Uniform Resource Identifier, is used to uniquely identify resources on the web, and Unicode makes it possible to build web pages that can be read and write in human languages. For instance, you are writing a particular thing, like you are creating a web page in which you want to insert a login, like username and password. How this has been done? This has been done with reference to the URIs, and also with reference to the things like syntax. What is the things with reference to syntax? We will be studying with reference to XML, HTML. Now, what is this HTML and XML? HTML is used to represent the data, whereas XML is used to describe that particular data. This is the major difference between HTML and XML. HTML is used to present the data, whereas XML is used to describe the data. In the sense, HTML is a front end and XML is a back end which is used to describe that particular data. Now, what is the full form of HTML? HTML stands for hypertext markup language and XML stands for extensible markup language. Now, what XML does? XML helps to define common syntax in semantic web. Also, I told you about the syntax and semantics. There is a lot of difference between syntax and semantics. The overall thing is semantics is for the actual meaning of the things. Okay. Now, the next one is data interchange. Now, what is in there in data interchange? Resource description framework. Now, what it does? RDF. RDF is a framework helps in defining the core presentation of data for web. RDF represents data about resource in graph form, with reference to the graph form. Now, what do I mean by taxonomies? Taxonomies in the sense, RDF schemas or RDFS allows more standard description of taxonomies and other ontological structures. Now, what do you mean by the ontology? What do you mean by taxonomy? Taxonomy is in the sense the different types of it. And ontology means how it is been implemented, how that particular thing is been implemented. Now, what are ontologies? Web ontology language offers more construct over RDFS. It comes in the following three versions. The first one is OWL Lite, OWL DL, and OWL. Now, what is this OWL Lite for? OWL Lite for taxonomies and simple constraints. And OWL DL is for full description of logical support, and whereas with reference to OWL for more syntactic freedom of RDF. Now, with reference to the rules, RIF and SWRL offer rules beyond the constructs that are available from RDFs and OWL. Simple protocols and RDF query language is like SQL language used for querying RDF data and OWL ontologies. Now, what are the proofs? All semantic and rules that are executed at layers below proofs and their results will be used to prove the deductions. Now, with reference to the cryptography, cryptography means such as a digital signature for verification of other origins of resources is being used. With reference to the cryptography, the key that will be used is being represented over here with reference to the key to encode and decode the information. The information that is been passed on the web should be secured with reference to the cryptography. Okay, encrypting and decrypting of the things. Now the next one is user interface and application. On the top of the layers, user interface and application layer is built for user interaction. Now, what are the operations with reference to World Wide Web? The first one, it says WWW or World Wide Web works on client-server approach. Following steps explain how the web works. Now, user enters a URL, say http://www.abcdef.com on the web page in the address bar of the web browser. Now, this web browser that you are using becomes your client, and you yourself, as of now, of accessing these particular things becomes a client system. Now, then the browser requests a domain name server for the IP address corresponding to www.abcdef.com. Now, after receiving the IP address, browser sends a request for web page to the web server using HTTP protocol, which specifies the way browser and web server communicates. And also remember, WWW works on two-tier architecture. The first one is the client and the second one is the server. The web client and web server. Now, the next point it says, then the web server receives requests using HTTP protocol and checks its search for requested web page. If found, it return back to the web browser and close the HTTP connection. Now, the web browser receives the web page, it interprets and it and display the content of web page in the web browser window. This is how www operations are being carried out. This is how the operations of www is being done, how it requests for the things and how the things are being responded with reference to the, those things. The client or the web browser that is being used is called as web client, and from where these results are coming are called as web servers. Those are called the web servers. Now, with reference to the web pages, how you will design the web pages? We'll be designing the web pages using HTML, JavaScript, and CSS, and all these things is being used to design and develop web pages. Now, the next one is World Wide Web static web documents. Now, World Wide Web is been divided with reference to the websites. It is been divided in different forms. The first one is with reference to a personal website. The second one is for a business purpose. And the third one is the governmental websites. Okay, if at all if you remember, these websites have their own different IP addresses with reference to their class addresses, with reference to the IP address that has been provided to it. Now, with reference to the World Wide Web, the web pages are been divided into three types. The first one is a personal website that you will be creating for your own self. The second one is a business website that you will be having with reference to different businesses, for banking, for other industrial purposes. The third ones are the governmental website that is been used for governmental purpose, like for state government, central government, railways, and for different things. You're using different web pages and web servers. Now, with reference to the appearance of the web pages have been classified into two types. The first one are the static web pages, and the second one are the dynamic web pages. I guess you have learned all of these things with reference to your web application and in the subject called as web application and development. Okay, now static web pages and dynamic web pages. I guess you know the difference between, but still as a part of your syllabus, we need to study World Wide Web static web documents or static web pages. Static web pages are also known as flat or stationary web pages. They are loaded on the client browser as exactly they are stored on web server. Such web pages contains only static information. User can only read the information but can't do any modification or interact with the information. Now, the next one, it says static web pages are created using only HTML. Static web pages are only used when information is no more required to be modified. Now, what is the use of the static web pages? For an instance, I want to give a description of my company or an institution. So what I'll do, I'll make that particular task as static. Why? Because nothing is to be updated. As of now, nothing is to be updated. Nobody can dynamically update that particular information. So that type of web pages are called as static web pages or static web documents. Now, this is a pictorial representation with reference to the static web document or static web pages. Now, the next one is the advantages of static websites, the different advantages with reference to the static websites. Now, what are the first advantage? Provide improvised security over dynamic websites. Dynamic websites are at risk to all web shell attacks if a vulnerability is present. The next point is improved performance for end user compared to dynamic websites. Now, the third point is fewer or no dependency on systems such as database on other application server, because it is being written as an individual unit, so it does not need any of the backend support. And the fourth point is cost saving from utilizing cloud storages as opposed to a hosted environment. The last point is security configurations are easy to set up, which makes it more secure. Why it has been like told as secure? Why? Because the reason is it is static and it resides on your own system. So that's the reason the chances of getting attacked to that particular World Wide Web or to that particular web page is very low. So So this is the advantages with reference to static websites or static web pages. Now I stop it over here, and I hope that you have understood something from today's session. If at all you have any doubt with reference to today's session, please let me know on my email address, or you can ping me on my email address rahmat_letter@yahoo.com, or you can come down to the college for a personal doubt clarification session. That's all for now. Hope to see you in the next session. Until then, take care. Bye bye.